Hello, everyone. Thanks for tuning in. It's itsmontez.com, and we have got a special episode for you today. Usually on Get This Knowledge, we talk about some other things, give you knowledge on how to get further into things, but today the topic is going to be a little bit different. White versus black. And then from that point of view, we're going to talk about what's going on into the global election inside the whole politics and with Donald Trump, Hillary Clinton. I don't know if y'all tuned into the debate, if y'all watched the debate, if y'all took time to view in on that, but we did some study on it, and we're going to talk about some points. Me and John are very good friends, but as you can tell, he's white, I'm black. He has a different upbringing. I have a different upbringing. We're not all of the same people. I don't know if y'all are familiar with the whole story of me being adopted and everything, but I was adopted. I grew up in a white family. John is Caucasian. He grew up in a white family. And all of his living that he's gone through is not, it's not how, you know, maybe you might say rich, white, you know, or any of this. You know, he's not that way. He's not broke. You know, he's not a bum or any of that. But he has a different view on how Caucasians might see things. And I have a different view on how black people might see things. So we're going to go in and we're going to have that conversation. It's going to be very powerful. I hope that you all can enjoy that conversation. Again, it's just our opinions and how we see things. If you have something to say and you have some type of comment that you could put inside the box, everything's live. So we can go on to the chat box, into the chat room. You could just post your comment right there. We can read the comment as soon as it goes across, and we'll answer it as soon as we get to it the best that we can. Anyway, without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and introduce John Pounders to the scene. John, thank you so much for being on today.
Hey, thanks, Montez. And like you said, man, we're both friends at the end of the day. And even now, we do have different opinions. We've talked about this before. And but you know what? It's good to come to something terms with stuff, because this is not something that's really talked about between black and white people much. There's some kind of divide there. And the way I've always looked at this whole thing is, and I guess I wouldn't say always looked at it. The way I've recently looked at this thing, I look at it as a division by the global elitists, by the people that want to destroy us, by the people that are controlling us. What most people don't understand, and this is something that if you look at Now You See TV, we've talked about in many, many shows, me and my co-host John Hall, and we've had guests on after guests. We've exposed this. This is something that's been going on for ever since the beginning of time, ever since before the flood, and even after the flood. As soon as after the flood came, the enemy came in and sowed their seeds. And this thing has been going on for a long time. Humanity and the seed of the serpent. And I'm not talking about, you know, there's a different serpent seed ideology or whatever, but I'm talking about the Bible says that we'll bruise his head, the seed of the man and the seed of the serpent. It talks about that division all throughout the Bible and how they'll always be at war together. Well, as humanity are at war against these serpent people that are leading our world. And I'm not talking about reptilians. I'm not talking about anything like that. I'm talking about people that are sons of the devil. The Bible, you know, Yeshua, Jesus called these people vipers. They said that they're of the synagogue of Satan, that their father is the devil. A lot of these people are running the world now. A lot of these people that are in power are kings. They have been running the world for a long time. They've taken over humans. They've taken over everything. And the devil, according to Paul, is the prince of the air. He's the power of the air. He's also the king of the world right now. He is the one in control of this world. And so when I look at black and white people, I look at two different colors. There's definitely differences in black and white people. Black people have great things about them that they can do that white people can't do. White people have great things about them that black people can't do. And I celebrate the diversity, the differences between them. You know, being a person that grew up in South Texas, where 1% white, the rest were Mexican. And so I know a little bit what it's like to be a minority growing up in a place where you are the minority, and it can hurt, but at the same time, it's a good growing up with adversity makes you stronger in the end. And like Montez said, I'm not poor now. I mean, I grew up poor. My parents were poor. They slowly, you know, they made their way up. That's what we come from. I mean, we've done that. We've overcome. But I can tell you, if I hadn't gone through all the adversity that I've gone through in my life, I don't think I'd be in the position that I am right now. doing what I'm doing right now. So I do am thankful for it, although it is hurtful as a kid. You know, you have crazy things happen. Being a minority sucks sometimes when people don't want to hang out with you because you're white, or their parents won't let you hang out with you because you're white, or because you're black, or whatever color you may be, or, you know, whatever it is. I mean, I've had that happen to me as well, and it's not a good feeling. But when we talk about this kind of stuff, it's important to realize too that not all white people are the same, and not all black people are the same. White people, I'm white, I look white, I'm white. But more than anything, I'm Indian and Irish and English. I'm a mix. I'm a mutt of all kinds of different things. So I'm not 100% white, 100% this or that. Most of my family is, you know, third or fourth generation American. So, like, you know, other than the Indian side of me, which my grandpa was full-blooded Indian. So, there's a lot of history in our lives. So all white people are not the same just because we look white. All black people are not from the same area either. And all black people aren't African. All black people aren't South African, aren't Ethiopian or whatever. So we're all different. And you know, diversity is important in my opinion. But basically that's where I'm coming from. I'm coming from the idea that we are divided on a lot of issues. I know that I don't understand fully everything black people are going through. And I'm hoping Montez can kind of fill me in on a little bit of that. I'm hoping that you can, you know, kind of speak to that, so white people that are listening can understand. And I'm hoping that I can speak so that black people that are listening can understand where white people are coming from, certain kinds. Like I said, I can't speak for all white people. There's some white people that are just jerks, rich, snobby little whatevers that grew up with a silver spoon in their mouth and think they're better than everybody. And then there's the rednecks that just don't give a crap about anybody. They, you know, slit a goat's throat just for fun, you know? So, I mean, I'm not talking for every white person. I'm talking for normal white people, normal people that have a brain and they are not hateful. So that's the kind of people I'm talking for. And Montez, you did a good job of describing where you came from. So anyways, thanks for having me on the show. That was a long intro to myself, I guess.
Hey, but you know, the intro was pretty powerful. The intro had a lot of information chucked inside of it, telling people about who you are and what it is that you come from and what you do. Like I said as well, it's just not really my own opinion. This is how I put this up. You know, this is how I'm taking it in. I'm not speaking for every black person, but I do see inside the gates. But going into what we're going to progress in, if you have any questions, make sure that you leave them inside the comment box on this chat. It's live, so we'll be able to respond to you right then and there. And we'll address to it as soon as we get to that point. But when we're going into this whole topic of black versus white, a big thing that you might see going on is the Black Lives Matter movement. There's a whole lot of different ways that people are looking at the whole thing. It's kind of harsh to come in to the show just automatically right on force to such a touchy topic. But I'm going to ask John, what do you think about the Black Lives Matter movement? Like, can you give us your feedback on what you think about it and how it's going on? And is it beneficial?
Man, that is a touchy subject you got there. And I can tell you how I look at it. I mean, you know, when I see people that are standing up for themselves, I think that's great. You know, there definitely should. When you look at black people that are being harassed by police officers, that's uncalled for. That should never happen. And it does happen. It happens all the time. People want to say it doesn't happen. Yes, it does. I was harassed by cops when I was a young teenager. I mean, I remember them raiding my house for no reason other than the neighbor down the road didn't like me. He was a cop. They raided my house. They pulled me over every chance they got, harassed me all the time. And so it happens even to anybody. And I can imagine being black. There's a lot of racist people that become cops. Cops are, and most of the people that I know that are cops are really nice people. I have one of my best friends is a detective. The person that led me to the Messiah was a detective on the police force. So there's good people in the police force, but there are people that abuse the power. Anybody that can hold on to a little bit of power, these bullies that get in there, they come in and they want to use their power. And then there's people that are just, they want to go home to their family. And then but when I see some of these things, okay, that happen, like I look at Ferguson, for instance. Ferguson, people think, oh, this guy was this or that, but there's video footage of this guy robbing people before. There's video footage of him being violent. and maybe I'm not thinking of Ferguson. Maybe I'm thinking wherever the guy was. Is it Mike Brown? I believe Mike Brown. Was that Ferguson?
Yeah, I think it was.
Okay. Mike Brown. I mean, here's pictures of him choking a dude out, choking a guy out at a gas station, robbing it. According to the police officer, he approached him trying to kill him. I can say this, if I'm a cop and somebody's approaching me trying to kill me, I'm going to kill them because I want to go home to my family at night, you know?
They had a film one time that came out, and it was basically how would a black man react if white or black, whatever it was, the person that they walked up on the scene with, how would they react? And of course, in the Black Lives Matter movement, they're saying, hey, look, you know, you need to quit using so much excessive force. So the African-American cop goes out there. He has his all suited up. You know what I mean? He's got the whole suit on. He's got the bulletproof vest. And he's got the decoy guy out there. The guy is playing around. And he's going to have to decide whether or not he's going to shoot the man or he's going to die. So it's almost like Alien versus Predator kind of thing going on here. But then when they're doing this, so the black man goes out there, the cop, the officer, the Black Lives Matter movement chief, you know, the main man. He goes out there and he's telling the guy, hey, slow down, you know, don't come at me, you know, hands in the air. And the guy actually lunges at him and stabs him with his knife for pretend. You know what I mean? It wasn't really real, but the man would have been dead, wasted. And so like the black man, he says, you know, at that time, I don't really know if I would have reacted the same way. I mean, because, you know, again, like I must say it's a little bit different when you're playing and with fire. I guess you would say, like, basically, cat's got the gun, you know? So, like, some people, what goes on, especially within the medication that people are on, you don't really know how to take these people. So, like, I can't say that, like, shooting someone is the best result. I wouldn't say that that's the best way to go. But then again, what if you're walking inside those shoes? That's what I tend to think to myself.
Yeah. Like, the way I look at it is, like, if I'm a police officer and I know that, like, my family depends on me, they love me, I love them. I want to go home to them at the end of the night. And there's a guy approaching me that's violent and he's trying to be violent towards me. I want to end this thing quick so I don't die, because cops die in the line of duty all the time too. People don't realize that cops get killed. I mean, it's happened here. It happens in Chicago. It happens all over the world. Cops get killed in the line of duty. When you're trained in a certain situation, when somebody's going for stuff, you're trained to react in a certain way. That's going to happen. People are going to get killed. And the thing about Black Lives Matters to me, though, to get back to my point, black people should never be killed by cops for no reason. Never. I mean, there's nobody in their right mind that would say that should happen. Okay. But when Black Lives Matters choose to have somebody like Mike Brown as their alter, whatever you want to call it, they have him as their little chant, their Mike Brown guy, when he's a thug, he tried to rob somebody. There's a video surfacing where he just beat the tar out of this other guy in the neighborhood. He beat the tar out of him, took his money and stuff like that. There's all these videos surfacing, you know, that show what kind of person Mike Brown was. So when Black Lives Matters chooses to make that their spokesperson per se, that was where the problem lies.
I can see the nature of why they decide to do that. Like, so like in me looking on the outside in, so, like, again, if we're looking at, like, Black Lives Matter movement and we're looking at intimidation, we're looking at people that are, like, all right, we're tired of getting shot. African-American people, we're tired of getting shot. So, again, like, if we go back to what you said, the training of the police officers and things like that, it's just, like, their nature. It's just what it is. So, if you look, again, like, I remember we were talking today, we were talking about a video of how stereotypical people are. You're going to walk down the street on the side with a whole bunch of bikers, or you're going to walk on the side of the street with a black nerd, a guy that looks like a nerdy man. So, like, if you look at these different things like that and you're looking at those, maybe it's the fear. It's the fear. So, like, when we go back at it, I think there's a thing that goes on. There's a stigma that goes on. I think that African Americans have this pain of fear inside of that's been given to them. Not so much as, like, because it's just the way it is, but I think it's because of so much of the trials and tribulations that went in through slavery and stuff like that. Like, again, MTV had some hate white people hate themselves came out. It was like some show that came out where it was like we're white, but we're ashamed of ourselves because we did this to the black people. You know, I think that has a little bit of a lot to do with it, because a lot of black people are resentful of the whole slavery situation. So when a police officer pulls somebody over, especially, again, if you look at the person in their clothing, I mean, it's bad to say, but I can't say that I don't prejudge people. I can't say that I don't do that, but if the cop pulls out a man, he's got on the baggy clothes, he's got the outfit, he's got the golds, he's got the slugs in his mouth, he's got his eyebrows slit, you know, whatever, you know, if he plays a role, I mean, can you really say that the man's not supposed to feel unintimidated? You know, I mean, so like,
yeah, I know, I understand, and that makes sense because you're right. I mean, there's always this fear, you know, that white people have enslaved you before. I get that that has to be something that's in the back of your head. You know that there's tendencies or whatever here and there. And I can understand. Let me rephrase the way I think. The Mike Brown incident, I can understand why people got upset about it, but I don't understand mainly is that when the facts came out about who this character was, why there wasn't a drawback from promoting Mike Brown. Because at first I understand, like, okay, a black man got killed by the police. I get it. But when there's evidence that he approached the man trying to kill the guy, he's a lot bigger than the guy. This guy's huge. There's evidence that he just robbed a place down the road. There's evidence that he beat somebody up and took their money and all this stuff. Then, like, you know, you have to, as a normal human, you would think, like, you know, if you wouldn't promote a guy like that. I know you wouldn't. I wouldn't promote a guy like that.
I wouldn't promote him. But then again, like, you got to, like, not to cut you off or anything, but then again, it's almost like, again, today's Christopher Columbus, or what's today? Isn't it Christopher Columbus Day?
Yeah.
All right. So, like, this man, what did he do? You know what I mean? Why does he got this wonderful
Most people have no idea what he did or anything like that anyway. You know, I saw a video where a guy went down through a street and asked people what 4th of July meant. They didn't even know. So people were dumb anyway. But what I'm saying is, like, the media, I think the media played a big part in this whole thing. Also, George Soros, huge deal for Black Lives Matter. And Black Lives Matter has no idea that an old, crusty old white man is the one that's forming and funding their operations. Millions of dollars being dumped into Black Lives Matter by some crusty old white man, this evil guy, thinks he's God, bankrupt several countries.
And they even bragged about it. If you check out on Alex Jones, the man even bragged about it, talking about overthrowing the system and making it to where they can't even get the money. So that's crazy, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's crazy. And like, I have a video, if you want to see it, it's like a 10-minute video. And I don't know if you want to watch it, but I did a video about, and if people just want to go back, they can check it out. But it's called Puppet Masters Part 2 on Now You See TV. And it explains George Soros and all the stuff that he's done. This guy's a wicked, evil guy.
Yeah, let's check it out. Can we play it right now? Is there any way we can play it now?
Right now. Hold on just 1 second. Let me get this going here.
Well, while you're getting it going, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for tuning in. If you're just now tuning in to what's going on, we're basically talking about white versus black. And then we're talking about the situations that white people deal with, the situations black people deal with. John's going to be putting on the screen right now the founder of Black Lives Matter, George Soros. So it's going to be pretty informational. A lot of people are going to be able to take this in. But if you can, 10 minutes. Let us have you watch this and get your opinions and feedback through it.
Yeah, this guy, I call him one of the most evil men in the world personally. But he, and then this video I made, he is actually 80 something now. I think I said 60 something in this video. But other than that, all the information in this video is 100% factual. Everything in it is true. And he's done all these things. And this is the guy behind Black Lives Matter. So during Ferguson, the interesting part, you've seen the fires, you've seen the riots and stuff. A lot of the people that started this stuff were shipped in by George Soros himself. I actually did another video about one of the people that George Soros is funding. He was a Black Lives Matter leader, and he is he threatened riots if these wins. But these are people that shipped into Ferguson that weren't in Ferguson. A lot of the people that were doing these riots were not people that lived in Ferguson. And this is my main thing, is letting you show you how the media and how these people are manipulating Black Lives Matter. They're manipulating black and white people on a mass scale. And so that's my whole point of this whole thing. I mean, not to like say black people are wrong for believing this way or white people are wrong, because I can totally get, man. I mean, police, you know, will make you so mad. They'll do things that are ridiculous. I mean, there's been times in my life that I wanted to run up on a cop and just bust his head open. You know what I mean? So I get it. Don't get me wrong. I get that stuff, but I want to, you know, I want to expose the manipulation behind this stuff. And I also want to just see the points of view. So anyway, I'm going to play this video. It's like 11 minutes long. And if once it gets to a certain point, I'll probably stop it. But you guys check this out. It's really important. And it's really for anybody listening that might be a part of Black Lives Matters, it's good to know who's funding you, because that's who controls you and that's who is filling your head.
And again, it's not that we wish that it'd be this way. It's not that we want it to be this way. It's not that I'm even opposing things. It's just like, here's the facts. Let's lay them out on the table. There's lots of people that know about the situation. All you have to do is go through Google. That's a big topic, what's going on right now inside of channels and people's lives. It's not that hard. Research, ask Google what the question is. We all have cell phones, pick up our cell phone, Google who's George Soros and find out. But
yeah, here we go. I put a lot of it together for you guys, so you get to check it out. It's pretty cool. I did it a while back, but it's really informational. So here we go.
The person I'm going to be talking about right now, most of you have never even heard of, but he's very rich, very powerful. With me from childhood, which I felt I had to control. Otherwise, I might end up in the loony bin. But when I made my way into the world, I wanted to indulge myself in my fantasies to the extents I could afford. As you can see, this guy is rather full of himself, and he has the money to back up his thoughts. So he thinks that he is some kind of god. He thinks it is his job to control the world and how it works. Like I stated in my previous video, a lot of people are arguing about presidents. Who is going to be the president? Who should be the president? Who's the best man for the job? If they're not puppets by the time they reach inauguration, they will be assassinated. Soros has been identified as a front man of the Anglo-French Rothschilds banking group. And of course, neither he nor the Rothschilds want this fact to be public, but there are many connections to be made between these two. In Soros, the unauthorized biography, pages 5 and 6. As September 15th wore on, George Soros's confidence that Britain would pull the pound out of the ERM was growing. It had been Stanley Druckenmiller who had thought the time ripe for making a bet against the sterling. He talked to Soros about doing something. Soros gave him the green light, but urged his head trader to bet an even larger sum than Druckenmiller had in mind. And so Druckenmiller, acting for Soros, sold $10 billion worth of sterling. The next morning at 7 o'clock, the phone rang at Soros' home. It was Stan Druckenmiller with news. While George Soros had slept, he racked a profit of $958 million. When Soros' gains from the other positions he took during the ERM crisis were tallied, he racked up close to $2 billion. It was this bet, this single act of placing $10 billion on the fact that Britain would have to devalue the pound, that made George Soros world famous. In Time magazine, September 1st, 1997, Soros said of this event, "I had no platform, so I deliberately did the sterling thing to create a platform." In 1997, during the Asian financial crisis, the then Malaysian Prime Minister, Mahathir bin Mohamad, accused him of bringing down the Malaysian currency. In Thailand, he was branded an economic war criminal who sucks the blood from the people. It's clear to see that George Soros is a major player. He's a 64-year-old Hungarian with an American passport that is devaluing currencies all across the world. His progressive ideology is being forced on the American people. This 64-year-old senior citizen that is not even from our country provided at least $33 million in a single year to radical leftist groups orchestrating protests and unrest in Ferguson, Missouri and nationwide, according to an explosive investigation into filings of globalist financiers, philanthropic tax-exempt open society foundations. Dozens of Soros-funded outfits help lobby the media, bust in AstroTurf protesters and community organizers, coordinate propaganda messages, create an echo chamber, and more, the Washington Times revealed. So can you believe this? He's not even a citizen of our country, and he's busing in protesters, organizers, and we all know what happened in Ferguson. It was a violent mess, complete chaos. He's a race baiter, and he's trying to cause civil unrest in our country, and people don't see this. All they see is black this, white this, Jew this, Muslim this. These people are causing this to happen. They are propaganda all over the place, and people don't realize that they're falling for this propaganda. When you watch CNN, when you watch Fox, when you watch all these companies, George Soros has his hand in almost every single one of them, okay? And not only him, all these elitists have their hands in these media organizations. It's nothing but propaganda. They're feeding the information that you see. If you can watch these propaganda organizations and keep in mind what they're trying to do, you might be all right. If not, it's best to turn it off. Quit watching it. It's their form of control. He dumps billions of dollars into these fake grassroots companies that he just makes up to fit his agenda. Grassroots companies normally operate in a way that the citizens have a problem and they try to solve it through a grassroots organization. What he's doing is he's paying to operate a grassroots organization and paying the members to do the job that he wants to have done. It would be like if I wanted to lower the cost of ice cream. So I funded a grassroots organization and made it their goal to lower the cost of ice cream while I sit back and have no involvement other than a donation. This is the same way that the Nazis accomplished many of their goals. George Soros is nothing more than a Nazi. He's a man that pushes propaganda, invests his money where he thinks he can make a difference and lead toward his globalization goal of the New World Order. A few other events that have happened that link George Soros to him are Occupy Wall Street and the turmoil in Ukraine. He gives more than $1.8 million to radio stations like NPR. So those of you that are listening to NPR, you are listening to the agenda of a 64-year-old non-resident of the United States. You're listening to the propaganda of a New World Order elitist. So I suggest that you find a new radio station. Viktor Orban, the prime minister of Soros' birth nation, stated that he has to deal with tens of thousands of second and third world immigrants streaming into his country and other European nations while Soros lives free of such inconveniences in his $10 million mansion outside of New York City. Soros himself is responsible for many of the migrant problems in Europe. He is basically destroying Europe for his own gain. There's a common divide and a common double standard with these elitists. They want the borders to be shut down and allow immigrants in everywhere, but yet they themselves would not have that. They live in $10 million castles and even bigger, while the regular people like us are being infiltrated by violent criminals and terrorists because of their policies. One thing that we need to remember in all of this is that all of this is ordained by our creator, Yahovah, to happen. Even though they are acting out the plans of the New World Order and are doing so evilly, they are still playing their part. The Bible says that the kings conspire against him. but he laughs. In the end, they will be defeated. Yeshua, or Jesus, will come back and he will claim his throne on the earth. And all of these people will hide in terror. They will be scared because there's nowhere to run from his face. They may sit in their lofty mansions right now, but we know that in the end, the power will be given unto our king. And he in turn will make us rulers of the new kingdom. So don't be scared. Don't worry. The Bible says to fear no man, to only fear Yahovah. So we don't fear these guys. We expose them. And the reason we expose them is so you will not fall for their tricks, so you won't be counted amongst the deceived. It's important that if you have not done this, you accept Yeshua as your Lord and Savior and repent of all the wicked things you have done and turn to him for guidance, because he's the only one that will be able to save us from the evil that is to come. These elitists don't care about you. In fact, they want you dead. They want to cause a World War III and depopulate so much of the earth so that they can have it all to themselves. So now's the time. Don't wait. Thank you guys for watching Now You See TV. And I want you guys to know that I love you very much. Otherwise, I would not be doing these videos. Thank you.
All right, so that's, you see it right there. That's the video that I did, and I know it was long, and I apologize for you guys if I lost your interest or whatever in the video. I think it's important. I think it's so important for people to realize that this whole thing is orchestrated. And the Bible even talks about a prophecy of race wars. And I'll pull up the verse here in a second, Montez. If you want to comment on this while I pull up the verse, I want to tell you a little bit about it. And my whole goal, like I said before, is not to down any particular race. It's not to bring anything, say white people are better, white people, you know better or anything like that. All people, almost everybody is manipulated by these forces. I mean, if you watch Fox News, if you watch CNN, if you watch MTV, if you watch MSNBC, if you listen to NPR, if you listen to talk radio, if you listen to these are all organizations where people like George Soros are controlling. So not only are you getting fed their information through media, but you're getting fed their information through Hollywood as well. They are pushing to go. I watched a movie the other night and I didn't watch the whole thing. I couldn't watch it. It was ridiculous. It was pushing an agenda the whole movie. That's the whole point of the movie. I shut it off part of the way through because I just saw it, man. And I look and when your eyes are open to this, when your eyes are open to the idea that this is not a black and white thing, this is not a race thing, this is a globalist thing against the human race and black people, white people, Mexicans, Middle East, whatever, we're all human race. We're all part of the human race, but there's a globalist elite. The Bible says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, wickedness, rulers of darkness of this world. These people are the people that we're talking about here. And I would go to say that they're not full people. They're part devil. They're part of the devil's clan or whatever. These are the people that are setting us up. Divide and conquer is the goal. And that's what they're doing. So anyways, go ahead and comment on it. And I'll pull up the verse that I was talking about, that Yeshua, Jesus, when I say Yeshua, that's his Hebrew name for Jesus. He prophesied about a race war. And I just want to stop it, man. I want to, like, this is the whole point of me doing this show or any show like this, is like to put an end to this. I mean, it would be great, you know, if people like us can have a mouthpiece enough to just warn people that this is all an agenda. But I know we're going up against a multi-billion dollar company, trillions of dollars of propaganda. And one thing a lot of people don't know is that in World War II, when the Nazis had what they called propaganda at the time, propaganda developed a stigma. And so they changed the name to media. Operation Paperclip is an important thing to know about, but they brought thousands of Nazis over to the United States and gave them jobs in media, science, NASA. I mean, all these different things that they gave them jobs in to help them bring in. So basically, in my opinion, the United States is nothing more than Nazi Germany. Now at this point, they're nothing more than Nazi Germany just remade and changed the terms so that people don't recognize it.
That's a very good analyzation there. I like how you put that together. So me personally, when I see hear George Soros and things like that, I first automatically I think of Hillary Clinton. And then when I think of her, I think of Margaret Sanger. So when you get down to Margaret Sanger and what she's done, I don't know if you've ever researched her. You can just go to Google, like I've told you all. Google's so powerful. Ask it who's Margaret Sanger and it'll have you know. But I'll give you a little bit of information about her anyway. She's one of the ladies that decided to go about the things called eugenics. Eugenics is basically the study of all human races, basically. So, like, whenever you're looking at Auschwitz, you know, when the Jews were put in those camps. And then if you look into slavery, black people in slavery. Then if you look into Hiroshima, to when we had Japanese into slavery, all these certain different times, even now, I'd even say like probably even the Syrians and Libya and then people like that. There's a lot of stuff going on over there that we're not very familiar with. So like chemical warfare, you're talking about psychological warfare. You're talking about lots of hidden types of warfare that doesn't, it's not really so much subjective to ouch, that hurt. It's more or less of, hey, it messed my mind up. So like when I sit back and I think about it and I look down at the study of eugenics and I look into all the start of where that came from. And then when you look into like African Americans and putting them on the slave ships and hanging their fathers and their mothers in front of them like it was no care. So if you talk about the whore, that thing that's stuck in people, I know that John, you all talk about on your show once before, you all were talking about programming of what they do to your mind. I can't remember if it's a NPR programming or what was that programming called, John? Did they do?
Man, people in the chat are saying that they're having problems seeing it. Are you guys still having problems? Some people were buffering. And this has happened to me twice with Now You See TV. When we have a show that hits hard and really makes a difference, and people, starts buffering and people lose it. So I'm asking, is it okay? So some people are seeing and hearing it fine. Great. This has happened two times so far on Now You See TV.
All right, so I remember what it was, not to cut you off. MLK Ultra, okay? So like
MK Ultra, yes, MK Ultra.
Yeah, so if you go through all the studies and how that exactly like played out and how that things went through it, at the time whenever they were like changing people's minds and going through all these different things, they say basically if you want to change a kid's mind and go through MK Ultra, you'll give them that kid at 3 years old, you'll like do some type of drastic thing to them. You might cut their hand off, or cut their finger off, or most times they rape the kid. Cause then after they rape them, that kid's scared to death, you know, and then they'll do it again after like when that kid's like 8 or 10 years old, they'll do it. And then so like after they do this to this kid so many times, psychological warfare, it's almost like you could tell this person what to do and they'll go do it just because they don't know what's coming next. Their mind's so messed up. So I only come back to say this is whenever you look at that and you look at those studies that they did to people, making them eat their own feces, setting somebody, you know, you can make a man go psychotic, put him in a white room, put him in an old white room, the man would go nuts, you know, but that's psychological warfare. It's not ouch, that hurt me, you cut me, you stabbed me, you shot me. This is mentally, physically messing your brain up type of thing. So I think that when it comes down to the George Soros situation and all the cops shooting the black people and stuff like that, I think it brings up the whole slavery stigma that goes with things. And it gets people kind of into that one knack mode of like, well, we've been put in that situation before. We don't want to be put into it again as black people. So I think George Soros is able to make things more possible because of that stigma that goes along with things. So I think the man is a terrible man. And then also on top of the fact is that he's making it off of pain. You know, everything's happening off of the suffrage of other people. And not only that, you know, even on top of it, before Black Lives Matter, people that were African American, they did stand up. But I don't think that the voice was heard. Again, like I people on my channel, they're always telling me, you know, Montez, why are you always on the internet? Why you always do this? Why is it? But here's the thing, is without the internet, we wouldn't know half the things that are going on. The power of the internet is so powerful. So like there's African American people that are trying to get the message out here's the reason why they can't get the message out. It's because they don't know the internet. You know, it's kind of crazy. Like, if you look at African Americans and you wonder why a lot of them are successful, it's kind of the situations that they put themselves in or they've been put in. It's not that they put themselves there. It's just that's the way their lifestyle is. Again, you break down the family, that's basically what they did. That's basically what happened. Is you attacked African Americans, Caucasians attacked African Americans and put them in plantations and stressed them out to the point to where, like, we don't know anything. So whenever situations come down to it, we've already been psychologically messed up. So yeah, then
I like how you tied that into MK Ultra, because I mean, you're exactly right. And you know what? They're doing it to everybody now. They're doing it to white people. They're doing it to Mexicans. They're doing it to all of us. And this MK Ultra thing, on a small scale, MK Ultra, we just had a victim of MK Ultra on our show not too long ago. And he's still a victim of MK Ultra. Like, they still do this stuff to this guy. And he's been on our show. He's written a book. He's one of the only people that has been able to come out about this and really. And he's actually by one of our David Carrico and his wife Donna led him to Jesus Christ and led him to the Messiah. And he hasn't had as many problems lately. He's been going through some stuff, but on a small scale, well, what they're doing there, they've been doing it to the entire world through propaganda. People, like, you're talking about black people have been put through all this stuff. Not only have they been put through all that stuff, but at the end of the day, when they watch TV, when they watch all these other things,
they go right back to it again.
Yeah. Yeah, man. I mean, busy people, successful people don't have time to watch TV. I mean, I don't have time to watch TV and watch all this bull crap that they show on there. I don't have time. I just go and I move forward and I do what I want to do. I push my own stuff, and I wouldn't call it propaganda. I push the truth, and I that's what I do. I don't care about what they have to say. They're liars. Every one of them are liars. The Bible says, "Let the word of God be true, and every man a liar." They're freaking liars.
And it's crazy that you say you know you don't watch TV. I don't watch it either. You know, I watch YouTube. You know what I mean? Everybody watches their YouTube channels. You know, but that's not television. Television is a little bit different. You're talking about Nickelodeon. You're talking about Hannah Montana when it was on. You're talking about all these different.
All that stuff, yeah. Disney, I mean, all of that stuff. Since the beginning, man, they start you at an early age. They start you from the very beginning. They get you hooked on Disney Junior, and then you move forward, Nickelodeon Junior, and then you just keep going and keep going, and it's just a freaking mind control, a constant mind control. And forgive me for saying freaking. I know people are like, you know, like that's just another word for the other F word. I'm sorry. I think, you know, honestly, I don't cuss hardly ever, but like, this is important to know. This is so important for us to even understand this stuff, because I'm telling you right now that this world is manipulated. This world is mind controlled, and with everything that I have every day through Now You See TV, I push to wake people up from this matrix that they're involved in. And this is no different. I'm so glad that we did this show, Montez, because we talk about a lot of things before, but this is important.
Yeah, I think the topic of what we're on tonight and really getting down in depth of what it really starts from, like Margaret Sanger, you're talking about eugenics, you talk about
Plant Parenthood, responsible for 44,000 people a day dying of abortion. She started that stuff.
The thing is that what kills me is within the African American culture. Why is it that I've said this before? Why is everyone talking about all the other situations when African American people, Caucasian people, Mexican people, Spanish people, whatever you are, we're all killing our children in our wombs? It reads in the Bible quite strictly what happens when you kill the unborn. It reads what happens.
We're all in this together. I mean, this is something that, like, you know, black people are been going through it for a long time. They got brought over in slave ships, but then you look at the Irish people that were slaves sent over to Barbados. You look at the Indians that got their whole life taken away. We came over here. White people came over here, and I don't, you know, the global elitist came over here, killed every one of them, just about sent the rest of them to plantations. These people are, and people want to say it's white people only. Yeah, there's a lot of white people that are wicked people. There's no doubt about it in my mind. There's a lot of white people that are very wicked people. There's a lot of black people that are very wicked people. There's a lot of Asian people that are very wicked people. This is a common thing in the world. Wicked people, people that follow after the flesh. If you read the scripture, it talks about people that go after the flesh. They go after the things of this world versus the things of the spirit. There's so many wicked people out here. They've gone through so much, Montez. They've gone through so much. For all you guys listening, I'm looking at the chat right now, and it's awesome to see you guys commenting. If you have any questions or anything you want to bring out, you know, go ahead and put it out in there, and we'll try to get to them or whatever. But my point being is we've all been manipulated to some point. There's white ghettos where people are just so dumb, they don't know anything because they've been dumbed down their whole life. They grew up, their mom was a crackhead, their dad wasn't there. Same with black generations in the hood. Thankfully, me and you, Montez, we grown up, we had really good parents. We had parents that cared
about. We were definitely blessed to have parents that, you know, tried their best to. I mean, I could have gone down a different path, you know, if it wasn't for God to grab me and say, hey, you know what, I want you to do this, you know. And it's not to say that I'm ashamed of my birth mother. It's not to say anything like that. But I do know that if I was to live that lifestyle before being adopted, I don't think that I'd be doing what I'm doing now. I'm pretty sure I wouldn't be doing it at all. I'd probably be out on the street selling drugs or something like this nature, or something just wasn't productive. But with that being said, though, you know, I think it's pretty big because, like, again, we go back to Margaret Sanger, we go back to eugenics, we go back to what goes on, breaking up the family. So, like, when we go to African Americans and we go to, because, again, it's not really just African Americans, because I think African American could fall down now to minority. If you live in a minority place and you have, like, income housing, food stamps, if you got that little cellular phone that you get because of the food stamps, you're a minority. So,
you know, it's hard to be. Yeah, I'm not to interrupt you, but it's hard to be a minority. People don't realize how fearful you have to be. I mean, like I told you guys before, I'm not like every white person, and I'm not trying to sound better than any other white people. I understand, you know, white people have their struggles, black people have their struggles. I grew up in South Texas in a border town, 1% white in that country, in that area. I, like, anytime a car came down the driveway, I freaking ran, dude. I ran to my house because white people were kidnapped on a daily basis, taken over to Mexico for sex slaves and for slavery and all that stuff, sold on the market, black market, over and over again every day. So I was in fear a lot. And plus, like, in the classes, like, I'm a white kid and there's all these Mexican kids, and they don't like white people. And all of them now, like, before I grew up and left that area, I became friends with all of them. You know, I became friends because they knew me. They're like, you know, this guy's cool. I've been there since I was 2 years old. They know me, you know, all the way up till I was 14. I overcame the whole thing, but there's fear in that. There was fear in the idea that I am alone, because we know that mob mentality of, like, a bunch of people getting together and becoming violent together is easy to happen. It can happen. It happens all the time, mob mentality. And so anyway, go on, man. I just wanted to interrupt you with that.
Yeah. So, like, I think it's very true. You know, a mob mentality, it just comes on. It's just what comes on to the nature. It's like, sometimes I might hear somebody singing a song, you know, I do the blues, but I've got a good friend, his name's JT Newton. And he sings, like, boy band style. Like, he's got, like, this Nirvana sound to him. He's got this crazy sound to him. If y'all look through my videos, you can find him at the State Theater, and you hear his voice, and you'll see what I'm talking about. And I always go to the sound of what his voice is. Even though I sing my own self, I still change my tempo to fit what his is. So it's crazy because, like, again, like when I was talking about splitting up the family and putting the family apart and things like that, if Section 8 housing, if you look at Section 8 housing, it's basically your mother and your kids could stay there, but the father's no longer playing a role if you get the discount, like the $18 a month or whatever to live here type of thing. But the father can't be around. So, like, if you look at these different lifestyles and you look at what's going on, it's basically, it kind of, like, brands over to the kids, if you will. What's good for the goose is good for the gander. You know, just like John said, if you keep on going through something, eventually it just rubs off onto the next person. So the kids, if they don't have any other kind of way to, like, look at something and get a different point of view from it, then it's kind of like, it's kind of this, they're kind of damned if they do, damned if they don't. excuse my language, if you all, you know, but it's basically how it is. Feed the snake for the rat, you know. So there's these type of things that'll go on, and after a trial, keep on going on, going on, going on. You get this crab in the bucket effect. You know, a lot of people say crab in the bucket. What does that mean? Oh, it's because each crab you get up, but the crab reaches up there and grabs you back down. You know, you get up, but somebody grabs up there and grabs you back down. So, you know, you deal with this situation, and then you look at what's after those situations are dealing with, and then psychological warfare within medicines. I know, John, you had a show on with Amy Denise, and you all were talking about what was the medicine y'all were talking about?
About kratom, which is a legal herb, or was it's legal still, thankfully, to a lot of the shows we did and the people that wrote the senators based on. And, you know, this is the thing, like, we can make a difference. We made a difference by doing shows with Amy Denise talking about this. People wrote their congressmen. These congressmen signed this bill. They
vetoed. It really did make a difference then.
It made a difference. And guess what? Like, people wrote their congressmen. They wrote their congressmen and asked them to sign this deal, and they did. And guess what? They prolonged the idea of kratom being legal. Kratom is a legal substance that is herbal, 100% herbal, 100% legal. It is a alternate to pain reliever. It doesn't get you high, but it relieves pain. It relieves anxiety. And this is they're trying to get rid of stuff like this. They don't like, you look at all the cancer doctors, the herbal cancer doctors that have turned up dead recently. They're dying. These pharmaceutical companies are controlling the world. And you said it right, where you're like crabs in a bucket. This is exactly what we are. They to these people, we're cattle, and they've said it. We're nothing but cattle to them. We're not people to them. We're nothing. We're livestock.
And you would think that within the humanity and the domains of humans, what we are capable of. But then again, I keep on preaching it. I keep on saying it. If you all don't catch up, it's going to pass up. Like, internet's really to the point now to where robots and things like that, it's really real. Like, I don't know if you all have taken the time. Again, there's this thing called Google. All you have to do is type in there. Robots 2016. They've got ones that are like dogs. They've got ones that do the weirdest things. They help. They bring you your coffee. They've got robots out here that are taking over people's jobs, basically. You know, so like if you're looking at these types of different things and how technology is progressing, if you look at VR, virtual reality, I don't know if you all spend any time. I actually had some time to be able to talk to Warren Whitlock. If you look back on the channel, I spoke with Warren Whitlock. He's a very influential man, and was noted by Forbes magazine for the top 10 influencers in 2009. So, like, but when we were looking at the apps and things that were going on, if you look at Pokemon Go, that was a big, big theory that a lot of people didn't understand. Pokemon Go is just a bigger way of creating turn-by-turn navigation, if you will. It was the same thing for that. So, like, basically, you got all these people walking around with their cell phones. Everybody's got their cell phone. Oh, there's a Charmander. Let me catch it. Yep, got him. But what just happened is inside this thing, it just took a picture of the bench sitting in the park. So now on the GPS, there's actually a bench sitting in the park now. So what basically just happened is you just work for free if you look at it in that long term. But then again, you're telling everyone where you're at, what you're giving every. But so this is basically how that worked. So human was smart enough to come up with the app to say, hey, I want to get better GPS all around the world. So we're going to come up with Pokemon Go. We're going to have people running around shooting pictures of Pokemon. Oh, there's one in the closet. Bow. Let me get him. Boop. Ah, now, you know what? They got a whole picture of your whole closet. But the thing is it crazy to think that? Is it crazy? Is it crazy to know that? Well, like John said, once you open your brain and you see these bigger things and you see these bigger pictures and you start to study on your own, like, again, we go to school. Me and John had a conversation a little while ago, algebra, history, all of history we had to relearn. You know, algebra, a lot of it we don't really even use. You know, so, like, if you really stop down and think, what's the power? Where's the power? And how do you get the power? And how do you share the power? And I think through social media, depending on how you're using it. Again, are you a consumer or are you a creator? You know, like, so, like, are you trying to be someone that wants to go be something different? Are you trying to, you know, so, like, you got to look at those things a lot differently And I really think that when we get into George Soros and we get into the Black Lives Matter movement and what goes on in African-American culture, Caucasian culture, Hispanic culture, when we look at those things and we look at, like, the tactics that's gone through what right now, basically through the TV, the television, through the radio, we look at all the different ways that it actually affects us. We kind of think have we lost it? Sometimes you sit back and you think, like, hey, am I losing it here?
No, dude, you're exactly right, man. Because I mean, that's exactly what, and that's, I've been that way, man. I mean, less than, okay, I became a believer, and I think this is like the cure-all is being a believer in the Messiah, being somebody that follows after Yahweh. I think Yeshua, Jesus, that is the cure, because there's a lot of different band-aids, you know, we can put on our skin. We can put on a band-aid of racial justice. We can put on the band-aid of healing certain things. We can do all these things. But the thing that opened my eyes was being a believer in Yahweh God, and believing in, when I say Yahweh, a lot of people don't know God's real name. God has a name, and his name is Yahweh, or some people pronounce it Yahovah. Once you go to him, you open, your eyes are opened. Your eyes are, you see things for what they are. And not everybody that claims to be a believer is a believer. There's billions of people in this world that claim to be believers. If there were billions of people in this world that were believers like me, and believers like Montez, believers like a lot of the people listening to this this show right now, this world would not be the way it is. It would not even be close to the way it is, because you know why? Because people would have their minds open. A billion people with their minds open is the scariest thing in the world to the elite. Black people and white people together in unity against these people is the scariest thing they can ever imagine. That, you know why? Because together we're powerful.
It's so true. It's like if you're going to go hit somebody, if you're hitting something, you hit them with the open hand. Yeah, this is going to hurt. You know, you're going to get a red mark. You know, you're going to get the. But if I hit you like this, so like it's like that, basically. People working together, being together, cherishing things together, are going to get a whole lot further than us being separate and being.
Yeah, I mean, like I said at the beginning of the show, black people have stuff they're better at than white people. White people have stuff they're better at than black people. And that's true. I mean, black people are a lot more athletic. They're also very good at entertainment and doing things that are awesome. They're good at just being a likable people. And then white people are pretty good with business. Imagine us together, unified together as one. The world would not be able to stop us. The elites would be scared to death of us because we're unified as one, as a strong body. They can't. Both of us together, they can't beat. They can beat us separated, because black people have things with them that are just, and it would be racist for me not to admit that there's differences in black and white people. There's differences.
Well, I mean, it's just true as that. You know what I mean? Like, look at my hair versus your hair. My hair is of wool. Yours isn't really so much now your beard, you know, but it's really true. You know, like we're different people. There's different things there's different muscles. There's different, our faces are shaped different. You know, there's different features in African than there is in the Caucasian, you know? So even if it goes into music, you know, if you're playing music, there's different instruments that African-Americans are just originally good at. There's instruments that Caucasians that are just originally good at. You know, so like there is that kind of thing that where there's just different. So again, like I've said before in one of our videos, I think it was with you and me, I was talking about basically I said there's a puzzle. We're a puzzle piece. You know, we're a puzzle piece. Without the other person to go inside the board, you got one piece that goes inside, you know, you fit in nice. But if you don't have somebody else to nudge up to you, it fits you just perfect to set you inside there, it's not going to work.
Yeah, man. Exactly. It's like having an engine without a transmission. What's the point? And that's what I'm saying. Like, black people and white people, they fit together like this. You know what I'm saying? Even Mexicans, all of us have our strong points. And when, as a human race, when we come together and we say, you know what, we're going to stand together because we are the human race. We are human. Yeah, there's black people, there's white people, there's Mexican, there's Chinese, whatever. But as together, we are something. We're something powerful. These people fear it. And you can tell they fear it. If they didn't fear it, they wouldn't do everything in their power to put us and pit us against each other with their media, with their presence, whatever, with George Soros putting billions of dollars, sending people to Ferguson to riot. I don't think the people there would have rioted and would have like would have done all that stuff if it wasn't for the people that he shipped in to do that.
Well, see, I think again, if you look into the agenda and stuff like that, again, I don't know if anyone's familiar with Alex Jones. He's got some very great products, Super Male Vitality. It's me and my wife. She has Female Vitality. But I take Super Male Vitality. Great stuff. Great products. Alex Jones got great products. And he also does good news. He reports. Now, I think sometimes he does blow things out of proportion a little bit. But then also, too, I can't say there's no reason not to blow it out of proportion. It's really that important, you know. So but when you look at what he's talking about and all the situations and what's going on there, and exactly all these things that are going on, I can't really say that, like, it's not I can't, you can't be wrong for wanting to spread the message. But really, again, it's like, what are you going to do to start spreading the message? You know, like, you got to find some way to get started, to getting into something. Like, John actually took me and helped me form my YouTube, and he's helping me day in. We got this channel called Get This Knowledge. We got a show. It's basically what this is, where we're teaching people how you can get the knowledge and go on to further information. Again, I am a light that might touch the African-American culture. John's a light that might touch the Caucasian culture. But us doing it together, we're touching both cultures. Because, again, I don't know the knowledge that John knows. But John giving me this knowledge, I get to give this to someone else. Again, white people tend to, if we're in the penitentiary, we're in jail system, not saying we want to be there, but if you look at how that goes, it's really segregated. That's the way it really is. That's just the way it is. So, but if you look at those things and you look at, like, so if John shares some information with me, I might have my fellow African-American brother come up and say, hey, how'd you do that? How'd you learn how to do that? So now I get to feed him the education. But he doesn't know it came from a Caucasian. You know, so like when you get down to those and you start thinking about those things, it's when you see those things, it's like, huh, why am I pushing to pull? You know, like it just doesn't make sense. So I really do think when it comes down to black versus white and the topic, it goes a lot deeper than being separated. It gets still so deep to the point to where separation isn't any kind of word that you want to use in the conversation. It just doesn't make sense. So with that being said, John, do you have any more about that? Do you want to go into the debate? I know a lot of people didn't watch the debate, but I mean, it's kind of juicy, right? Does anybody got any things to say? We can answer some questions, anything in the chat room.
Yeah, man, the debate was interesting. Last night I chose to spend with my family because I didn't want to watch it. I look at this stuff as propaganda tools, okay? But when I look at the debate like that I saw the other night, I don't know what to think sometimes, man, because I'm looking at it and I do think, like, it, one of the things that hit me the hardest is when Hillary Clinton said, we don't want guys with a temperament of Donald Trump controlling who goes to jail and who doesn't. And when he said that you should be in jail, like, it's because you should be in jail because I'll put you in jail or whatever he said exactly, like, that's so true. She should be in jail. These elitists, they don't go to jail. They do not go to jail. They do whatever they want. I mean, and it's interesting the way Donald Trump played it, because I look at, like, he had these people that Bill Clinton had sexually abused in some way or another, or used his power to manipulate these women, and they're sitting there in the front row. Right there. And you could tell, like, as soon as he said something about it, Hillary just zipped her mouth. She didn't say any more about it. It was an interesting show for sure. I don't know what to think. Like I said in the video that I showed you guys earlier with George Soros, I think that anybody that doesn't go along with the agenda of the elite gets put down, just like JFK did. JFK is a perfect example. Somebody that wanted to end secret societies, he wanted to end a national banking system. He got put down. He got put down like a dog, got shot and killed. Okay, I think if Trump is who he says he is, if he's literally against the elite system, then he will either get put down or God will sustain his life if that's true. Hillary, we already know she's a part of the elite system. She's one of their little lap dogs. She's been that way for 20, 30 years, the longest she's been in there. She's always been a lapdog. She is a racist. And it's interesting to me, Montez, one of the things that's interesting, maybe you can help me out with this, because this is something that I've never understood this. Why do black people go Democrat? Why? Because they are the most racist people in the world.
I really don't, as far as like African Americans voting Democrat or voting Republican, I think that had to do a lot with in the times of freed slaves. I think that kind of, and you know, like African Americans and even you know, kind of stuck in your ways, if you will. People get stuck in their ways, and then next thing you know, it's just the way my mom used to do it, so I'm going to do it again. It's just like kind of how it's programmed into the family, and I think a big thing of it is again like this. I think a lot of this stuff was pre-planned. 2016, this is what's going to be happening. You know, this is where African Americans should be, Caucasian should be. This is what the temperature of the room should feel like. And I think that set out and planned out, and it's been executed thus far.
And so, like, because when I look at Republicans, like, I don't look at I think every president that's ever been in office, Republican or Democrat, has been a lapdog of the elitist at this point, unless they were killed. And I laid it out perfectly. Like, that's exactly what I believe. I believe everybody that has ever been in office, and if they were not killed while in office since 1913 is when they signed the Federal Reserve Act, and that's when the bankers got control of our country. That's when the world got in control of our country. When I say the world, I mean the elite banking system, the elitists, they got control of our country in 1913. Anybody that has never been a part of that system, or anybody that has gotten into power that went against their system, has been killed. Okay, so I believe that every George Bush, all the Bushes, you can name any of them. They are part of the elite system, and they're puppets. And I'm clear about that.
I agree. I think that they're definitely used to get some type of point pushed across, or they're used to take things and make them happen, or they're used to be more influential. They're influential pieces, if you will. I think that you're right there when it comes to that. I do think that there are people that do get into the environment of things, and they think that they're going to go in and change things. Like they go in thinking, hey, look, I'm strong enough. I'm going to be able to handle this. But they're not fully equipped with the full armor of God. You know, I think you, again, like there's sometimes when we're just going through our life and we think that we have everything together. We think that we do, but then we really temptation is strong enough to break us. You know, there's things we don't have the breastplate on. We don't have the shield. We don't have the boots. We don't have the helmet. We don't have the sword. You know, we don't have these things. And all it really takes is just not having one piece of equipment, and it'll break you. So I think there are a lot of people that do go into the global elitist, if you will. I think they do try to go in at a different standard. Because, like, again, if you look at Donald Trump, you're fired. You know, I mean, like, so at one point in time, he was playing ball with them. You know, at one point in time, he was shooting free throws at the free throw line. You know, so it's kind of a shaky situation. But do I suggest that I'd have a woman that's falling down every other day, that's coughing up globulence out of her neck and passing out and stuff? I can't say that I'd like that. I mean, and then I just
she's had people. I mean, if you read the books that have been written about her, you read the things that she's done, and you see the emails that she's deleted. You see the people in Benghazi that died because of her. You see all the things, like she says, I want to do this with my presidency. She's been in office for 30 freaking years. She hasn't done squat to help anybody. And why do we believe her now that she's going to do anything? With Trump, we have no idea what's up with Trump. I mean, nobody knows. Trump is a guy that has not been in the political system ever in the entire, never been in political system. So when and this is coming from, and we're talked about, you know, trying to put white people's spin on Trump. Okay. Me personally, I believe that it doesn't matter who's elected. The agenda is the agenda, and it's going to happen. It doesn't matter. Like, I think they're both puppets, and possibly Trump may be a non-puppet, but if he is, he'll get killed. So, but I think when I look at like Hillary, this lady's evil. Like she's a wicked witch. She's a wicked witch of the North or whatever you want to call her. She's wicked. This lady's so evil. When I look at her, I see that. When I look at Trump, and this is like, this is coming from a white person's perspective. I see not no, you don't know. I see somebody that could be good, could be bad. We know that Hillary's wicked. We know that. Everybody knows that. Anybody that has their eyes open that really wants to see it knows that she's pro-abortion. And I don't care. I mean, people might be listening tonight and they disagree with me, but if you're pro-abortion, no more. Cut. That's it. I cut ties. That's it. You're cut. You're done. I mean, I have friends that have had abortions. And I love those people. And they're my friends, and I love them still to the very end. But when you're a politician and you support these things, these murders of 44,000 babies, Margaret Sanger, which was a huge racist, was the one that funded Planned Parenthood, that started Planned Parenthood. Hillary Clinton is a big part of her. She was a racist person. More black people die a day of abortions than any other race. Okay, so we see that. When I see that woman, when I see somebody that's pro-abortion, automatically, boom. I don't care what else they stand for. I could care less what else anybody other person stands for. If they're for abortion, no good. That's murder. The blood of the innocent cries out to the creator of the universe. It cries out from the ground. And we're going to support somebody like that? Heck no, dude. That lady right there should be chambered into a freaking cell and never let loose. That is evil and wicked. And if you're listening tonight and you don't believe that, I'm sorry, but it's true. These are innocent babies that were formed by Yahweh himself. They were formed from the womb to release into this world, and they're being killed inside the womb. That's evil and wicked. I don't care who you are. That's freaking wicked. And when I see Christian pastors and Christian people supporting Hillary Clinton, it pisses me off so badly. It makes me so mad, Montez.
I'm sorry,
but it makes me so mad when somebody supports somebody that is pro-abortion. It makes me so mad because when you're killing innocent babies, this is freaking wicked, okay? You're killing an innocent child.
I could totally agree with you, John. I think it's totally bad. It says he knew you in the womb. He knew you in the womb before you would ever come out. He knew what you'd look like. He had created you in his own image. You know, so like, and then you go and kill it. Like I don't get it.
I want to make it clear. I'm not supporting Trump. I'm not supporting anybody. I'm saying right now that if you're a Christian and you support Hillary straight up just because she's pro-choice, I mean, you need to reevaluate your freaking relationship.
Which again, I think people really need to go back and look at the moral things, the things that morally, is it right and morally, is it wrong? As people, as the government, I mean, we basically could stand up as people and get what we want as people. But then again, I think that people have to be awake. They have to be alert. They have to want to care. They have to, again, we got so many people stuck in Pokemon Go. We got so many people stuck in Facebook and Facebook Live and all these pointless things. You know, people are stuck in that world. Again, like the Democratic debate, it's on when sports are going on. You know, like why? Oh, so you don't want us to pay attention? Oh, I see where you're going with this. You know what I mean? Like, it doesn't make sense. Like, so which one, you know, we care about basketball as in a nation, football as in a nation. We care about this. You know, we care about these sports. We care hockey. We care, you know, we all care about these sports. But then for you to take it and put it in such a dire matter of what's going on inside of people's life, you know, like later on what's going to affect my kids, your grandkids, if you're not dead, their grandkids, you know, like it's just like, it's really appalling. It's really flabbergasting. It's just breathtaking to just think about like what exactly are they trying to pull here? What kind of stunt are you trying to pull here? You're gonna do sports?
Yeah, who knows what's gonna happen? And like I said, I'm not supporting either candidate. I think that doesn't matter who's the candidate. I think it doesn't matter who wins, to be honest with you, because until us as a nation decide to unify together, until we decide to repent of all the wickedness that we've done, until we decide to stand up for each other and move together and just make something of what we got, it doesn't matter. They're scared of us. There's no doubt about it. Why else would they put black against white? Because they know together we're strong. They know it. And I know it. I know that together black and white people are strong. I know this. And you know this, Montez, we know this. A lot of people have no idea. A lot of people think that we're different. We need to be segregated. We need to move together. No, we need to move together as a one unified front and move together. And this is the scariest thing that they'll ever see.
Well, I mean, I think it reads out in the Bible too. There's different nations of people that did different things. John, I'm pretty sure you're probably more educated. Anyone in the chat room, there are different people that did different things. Like even with the Indians, they had hunters, they had gatherers, they had planters. There are different people that did different things. So again, like I don't think that it would be practical to say, really, if you really stop and think about it, a lot of the African American people are inside cities and suburbs and so on and so forth. But if you take this African American, you put him out in the country. I'm just saying, put him out in the country and say, look, I'm going to give you a country log cabin. I'm going to give you all the seeds. I'm going to give you all the things. And even as black people, like if you look back to the literature book, it even says, hey, we don't even know what we do anymore. What do you mean? We've been on the plantation. African Americans been on a plantation all this time. You mean to tell me you don't know how to plant corn? African Americans really don't know how to do that. And it's crazy because their whole lifestyles have been lived in the city. So like you take them out of the city and put them in the country and you say, now go live your life. Yeah. I'm telling you, you're going to want to find yourself a local Caucasian. I'm sure you might find you an African American out there, and all jokes aside, just trying to bring some nature into things, but really, for real.
Yeah. No, there's no end to the idea that if we were to start thinking together as a community of people to help each other, and we were a community of people that said, I'm a white person, but you know what? I'm going to help my fellow black people. I'm a black person, but I'm going to help my fellow white people. And we come together as brothers and sisters. I mean, they can't stop it. No, it doesn't matter what the government does. If we stop, okay, here's the deal. You stop listening to their propaganda. You stop listening to their news channel. You stop listening to their Hollywood propaganda. You stop all that. They have no control. They have no control. There's not enough troops in the world to control what we do when we start working together and take their propaganda and throw it in the garbage. There's nothing they can do. They're so fearful for them. When TV was created, when radio was created, that was such a control mechanism. We stop doing that. We start creating our own stuff and we start moving together. They would be frightened out of their pants. They wouldn't know what to do because there's 1%. 1% of the world controls 99% of the population. 1%. If we move together, they're frightened.
If you remember that song that came up, I'm trying to remember, it came on the transistor radio. I think it was something like the transistor radio, something like this, they were talking about when it came out. If you go back and listen to those lyrics about what they're talking about, the power of the radio, when you really think about it, everybody at 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, mom, dad's home, we're all done eating, or we're eating and we're all sitting watching this TV. Our eyes haven't moved. We haven't done anything. We're watching the TV. And then the thing about it is the subliminal messages. A lot of people don't catch those. They don't. But then again, I don't think you will catch it if you haven't tried to study for it. If you haven't tried to open your mind and look at other things, like again, this cool thing, Google. What are these subliminal messages? What is a subliminal message? Ask it. It'll tell you exactly what it is. You don't have to take my word for it. I'm not saying I have the knock on all theology and science, all these things. Again, me and John have said this before. We don't know it all. But again, if you go look and you go see what's going on, and if you stop and think, hey, when mom and dad did get a TV, we did just kind of sit there and stare at it. But it was at nighttime whenever all your chores were done, everything was done, you got to watch TV. So like if you sit down and you think about that, how much control it really had, if you really think about the newspaper, and people go out there every single morning, I'm going to my mailbox, I'm going to go get out my newspaper and I'm going to read it. I tell you what, my grandmother, I stayed there for 2 weeks, and every single day except for on Sundays, she'd have me go out there and get that paper. And every single day I'd come back in, she'd have her glass of coffee sitting right there on the side of the table, and she'd be sipping it, and she'd be thumbing through a newspaper. But that's where the propaganda hides. That's where the information hides. It's going over here, putting the wool over your eyes. That's where the propaganda goes. But then you can't really just tell that to an elderly person or elderly person. You can't just say, that TV, especially Jeopardy, my grandmother, she was on Jeopardy. I can't tell her, hey, look, you might want to turn that off. There's stuff that comes on the commercials that's going to mess your head up, grandma. You know, I can't really just tell grandma that. You know, I can't. You know, so there's a time, there's a place, there's a way. And well,
you're right. I mean, it's up to us, the younger generation, the people that are open to really make a difference. Give them an alternative. I mean, and that's the whole point of Now You See TV, is we give an alternative to the stuff that's already out there. We give alternative to the mysteries of the world. We get our alternative to all these different things. I mean, our channel is different than a lot of people's channels. We give an alternative to this all stuff. And that's the whole point of us. And you were talking about earlier, put a African-American out in the country, give them seeds and stuff. Do it to white people that are growing up in the ghetto too. Good to everybody. Everybody needs to learn. There's enough land in this world that people could really like. Most white people grew up in the city, never slaughtered an animal in their life. They'll eat 100 pounds of beef in a year, but they've never slaughtered an animal before ever. You know what I mean? Never slaughtered anything, never done anything. They don't even know what that is. And so like, and that's the thing that I want to get the point across to people is black or white, we're all being shafted. We're all slaves, whether we know it or not. We are all mind control slaves. Some of us feel different than others about what our world in this life is. There's 1% controlling 99%, 1%, 1%, 99% of us are all out there just trying to make it. 99% of us are all out there just trying to live, while that 1% has been wealthy from a long time. They've owned slaves. They've had this world underneath their thumb ever since after the flood, ever since the Tower of Babel, they've had their world underneath their thumb. And we are.
You say under my thumb, and again, this song, I can't remember who it is. Again, put it in the comment box and I'll be able to see it later on. Under my thumb, the girl chew. You know that song? That song, it's Jimmy Swagger, I think it was. If you listen to that song and what it has to say, but you were listening to it on the radio and it's going through your head, through one ear, staying in your brain. Cause I mean, like literally, I just sang part of the song. So like, it's really like that.
Yeah, you know,
it's crazy. The war, the psychological warfare, the war on your mind, like Alex Jones would say. You know, like it's crazy how that works, man.
It's been, and people. Somebody in the chat said more people need to wake up. You're right, and I would submit to the idea that by the time this election comes up, if Trump wins, there's going to be riots all over the world. Riots all over the United States. Stock up on your food and water for at least a week or two, because it's going to be riots if he wins. If he doesn't win, Hillary or Trump, I don't even know, but I know what will happen if Hillary wins. You will not see shows like this anymore. Freedom of speech will be cut off. This woman's a wicked woman. She says that our ideas need to be changed. She says that people get killed because they oppose what she does. She will cut off that. She will take away guns. She's a wicked woman.
Well, I guess the part that really
I don't even know what will happen if Trump wins, Montez. I have no idea, but I know what happens if Hillary wins. Bad things. If Trump wins, I know that there's going to be riots, and so be prepared.
There'll be riots because of the other side.
I just want to tell you people real quick, Montez. Sorry to interrupt you, but share this video right now with somebody, because I'm telling you this: you're not going to see black and white people getting along like this very often on a video talking about things that are important, that are true, and seeing the bigger picture. You're not going to see that. Most of the time people are so divided because of this haze that's been put over their eyes. They can't get past that haze. This is something special. All right. This is special. This is us seeing past our color. This is us seeing past the global elitist plan and seeing into what it is really like. This is special, and people need to see this. They need to see the special activity that is happening right here. Because I'm telling you right now, if our world thought like this, if our world came together as one, we would win. We are the winners. We are the ones that come out ahead. Plain and simple.
And I can't do anything but just to agree with that. I mean, it's really true. Like, forming with each other is just better. You know, have you ever played, would they play that game Smear the Queer, where you're all running all by yourself? You know, it hurt, right? You're the only one playing it. I'm sorry if it was a derogatory term. It was a derogatory game. You know, I don't know why they called it that, but you know, I played it I'm sure you played it too. You ran all by yourself and there'd be like 15 people coming after you and you're like running as fast as you can to get away. But then when you play football or you play rugby or something, like, it's not so bad, right? It's not so bad. You got a team that's going to protect you. You got the running back. I mean, there was a couple times that I could remember specifically Jakim Gatewood would not block where he was supposed to, and then I'd get my clock clean by Matt Treadway inside of the linebacker, and he was like this big ferocious, all he does is eat beef and potatoes, big man, and almost killed me. But anyway, with that being said, yeah, it's a lot easier playing as a team. So I think it all comes down to teamwork. I think that again, like if you look at like a team that's playing on baseball or football, you can have predominantly all white, you can have predominantly all black, but then what's the team if you put both of them together? I mean, don't those teams be kicking it? You know what I mean? They be doing really good stuff. So like, I really think that, or if you go through like sports like skateboarders, you can find one of those two or three of those African Americans that's hung out with a Caucasian long enough to learn how to do this kickflip. But I mean, he's the dopest skateboard you ever found. You know what I mean? But
rappers, you see, like most black people are good at rapping, or not all black people are good at rapping, but most of the rappers are black people that are good at it. And then every now and then you see this prodigy white guy that's hung out with black people long enough to be good at it. And it's like, imagine if we put ourselves together, man, how great we could be, because we're human, man. I mean, we're human, and God split us up at the Babylon. We are all split up into languages and different people. But now there's it's a controlling force that's trying to take us all over, and we have to come together, man. We have to enjoy each other. There's so much to enjoy about the black race. There's so much to enjoy about the white race. There's so much to enjoy about every race. Each person, each individual, just people in general, there's so much to enjoy. So much joy about women. There's so much joy about men. When we divide, like that's what they want us to do. When we divide,
I mean, that's basically like you said. Not to go on to a whole nother tangent because we're getting ready to wrap this up and stuff. It's 10:30. We've been going on for an hour 30 minutes. But it's basically like with this whole sexual gay agenda thing. Like, okay, so you want me to do another man so I can't have children. You want my women to do other women. You want this to happen so we can't go further into life. You know, so like when you look at those types of things and the way that they're playing that, like it's like, and then plus now AIDS is rampant, herpes is rampant. Like I dig Mayapple root, and right now Mayapple cures all your STDs. I have a video on my YouTube. I always go back to my channel and go through there, and it's how to, I think the video's title is Just Do It. And I'm digging Mayapple root. But those roots there cure these diseases. But right now, the price of those roots are going up. So what does that tell you? I'm just saying, syphilis and all this stuff's on an all-time high. Hey, I don't have the knock on everything. I don't know everything, but I'm just saying, you know, but.
No, exactly. And one thing I want to say real quick before we end the show. If you guys have any questions, and I see the chat, blowing up, if you have any questions, ask them. And also, we want to talk about more topics that are important. I mean, we talked about a lot of different topics in the past, but this is the kind of stuff that I think is a game changer in the world. This is not, we talked about how to succeed. We talked about our different things like that, but none of those things are as important as us coming together as the human race. None of those things. And this makes a difference. This makes a difference in the world. And so I'm definitely asking you and begging you, each one of you that watched this, if you were moved by this, if this had anything effect on your life, if this had, will you think it'll have effect on anybody else's life? Share this video out, because we have to make a difference in this. We have to, we don't have any other choice. Our children are going to grow up in a world where they're going to be tortured. They're going to be slaves. It's going to be the worst thing ever for our little babies that are growing up out here. If you don't have children yet, I'm telling you, you'll love them more than anything in the world. And to think of them as being slaves, to think of them as being nobodies, to think of them as being nothing. This is going to be a reality if we don't do something. So share this video out, make some videos like this. Black people, white people, get together and make videos. Show that we're unified. Show that we are one. Show that we do not subscribe to this foolishness that they show on this on TV. We don't subscribe to this crap. We don't just care about it just because the media cares about it. There's a lot of things that happen in the last three days that nobody even knew about, because you know why? They were worried about Trump saying something about grabbing a woman by the whatever. You know what I mean? They're worried about that. And every man in the world says something like that. I mean, if you haven't said anything like that, you're a freaking liar. Okay. I mean, 10 years ago, 11 years ago, I probably said stuff and did stuff like that all the time. I'm a believer now. I don't do that, but you've done it. Okay. Forget about that. What about Russia wanting to go to war with us, setting up for nuclear war, going into bunkers, 15 billion Russians going into bunkers, preparing for war. What about, Hillary deleting all these things? What about whatever else is going on in the world that's even more?
Like, what about abortion? What about companies leaving? What about, you know, like, what about all the people that are actually in Aleppo that need to be out of Aleppo? You know, what about all the people that are bleeding, the kids that, I mean, sure, I mean, adults need to come too, but why not the kids? You know what I mean? Like, you know, what about these things, the things that matter the most? You know, I think priorities are messed up. I think that when we take a good look at our priorities and what it is that keeps us going and what makes us want to keep going or going on around and about, when we analyze ourselves and start viewing, hey, how am I? Who am I? And what do I represent? When someone sees me, can they see light or do they see darkness? You know, if you start looking at yourself that way, like, how do you want people to see you? How do you want someone to perceive you? When someone sees me, I want them to feel good. I want them to feel the energy that I got. I want them to eventually be like, hey, I want to be happy too. And then when they ask me, hey, how are you so happy? And I'll tell them, well, you know, I believe in war. You know, I believe in this. I believe in that. I hold myself to these morals. I have myself with these standards. This is the way I am. This is how I do things. Now, you don't have to take it, but you could hear it. And if it makes that change for you and it changes for you, I'm pretty sure you're going to tell someone else. And that's how it works. Word, ear, you know, word of mouth, you know. But anyway.
No, you're right, man. And I just want to say that that's definitely – we want people to be able to feel comfortable with us. You know, we want people to love us and we want to love people. We don't like, I mean, who likes to have worry about violence everywhere they go? Who likes to worry about, you know, people thinking like this person's going to hurt me or whatever? We don't want that. We want people, you know, just, and that's why everybody should be. They want to help each other. They want to do things good for each other, to help lift each other up. And cause we can all be great, man. It doesn't have to be just a few of us. We can all be great. We can all lift each other up and we can all serve the Almighty King together. And we don't need these elitist chumps, Satan worshipers, because that's what they are. They're Satan worshipers. There are people that are probably children of Satan, literal children of Satan, that are up here controlling how we think and feel. They're controlling that. I mean, it can't get any more sad than that. They're controlling how we feel by their media.
It's really
sad, man. It's so sad. I mean, they're controlling how we feel, dude. I mean, they're controlling the people. You grasp that? They're controlling how you feel because of what you watch. People don't realize how much of an impact that has on them. You feel the way you feel based on what you put inside this thing right here. It's called your brain. This is your most powerful thing you have in your life, is this thing right here that's inside your head. And you put stuff into it that's poison, and they're poisoning you. They're poisoning you. They're controlling your brain. They're luring you into darkness or luring you into a trap. It's time to break it. It's time to break this crap and move forward. And that's all I have to say. But I want to thank you, Montez, for having me on. This has been a great show. And I really, if you're listening tonight, please share this with people. Get this out there. It's so important. And this is the first time I've ever done a show like this where we can, black and white, we can sit together. We can really just love each other and know that we are trying to move forward together in unity. This is important. People don't realize how important this is.
John, thank you so much for coming on. And likewise, I really do appreciate being able to just speak out with a friend, a family member, someone I care about, that's really helped me grow myself, you know. Being able to conversate and share our ideas and bring them to other people. That's basically what I like to do, is what this channel is for. That's basically what Get This Knowledge is for. It's just something to get you all thinking some kind of different way. Some other way, like sometimes you've got to hear it from somebody else. Sometimes you got to see it done by somebody else before you actually decide to go change whatever it is that you're doing. Whether or not you're trying to get more financials, or whether or not you're trying to get this new car, or somebody else can, or, you know, all these, somebody else is going to teach you or can teach you how to get to these things in these different levels. It goes through other people. So I really appreciate everyone that's tuned in. I really appreciate everyone that's watched it. Like John said, if you can, please share this. There's three key things. Susan, I know you hate it when I say this, but there's three key things. I need you to comment. I need you to share, and I need you to like it. Without doing that, it makes things very hard to know whether or not this topic's any good, or whether or not you all want to hear any more conversations about this. I have a question at the end of the show. How many people do you know that still know how to write cursive, and how old are they? Me and John were talking about that before we got on the show. We were thinking that cursive might end up being a secret language or written language. Like, if you think about foreigners and people like that, and people that don't know how to do cursive, they won't know how. A lot of our kids don't know how to do cursive. So my question is do you all know anyone that knows how to do cursive? And if you do, how old are they? Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a wonderful time today. I hope you all have enjoyed the conversations. It's been Get This Knowledge, where John Pounders and John Pounders from Now You See TV and me, Montez McCamish from itsmontez.com, come on and talk powerful topics. Without further ado, I'm going to bid you good day.
Good day. Blessings and shalom. Peace. Get together and enjoy each other.